you, nothing would happen at all. So thank you to all the organizers who have made it all possible. And I think we should also thank CIMAT and all the staff who I'm sure have done work for all of this happening. So thanks to everybody who has made this happening. Thanks to the video, thanks to all the help. Leticia knows better whom to thank. But thank you for your hospitality. Thank you. Okay, I hope you are ready for the last talk, and I hope you had a lot of coffee. We have, you know, my notes were probably 30 pages, and we went through 10, so the remaining 20. No, that's not true. Let me remind you where we were a couple hours ago. So I told you that there exists a compactification AG perfect cone, which from now on I'll just write as AG bar, and that's what I'll mean. This is a so-called toroidal compactification. It's defined using a cone decomposition. And I should have said, and thank you for telling me I should have said it and didn't, that the way the word toroidal appears is if you have a cone, this gives you a toric variety. I mean, the corresponding, whatever you call it, dual associated, I don't know. So this is a toric variety. So cones are toric varieties. And if you have a cone, its faces are other toric varieties. And the inclusion gets reversed. And somehow the way a smaller cone sits in a bigger cone tells you how the different strata of a boundary of a toroidal compactification get attached. So the data of this cone decomposition really tells you what toric varieties you will expect as fibers over a fiber-wise product of the universal family over the Euler space of abelian varieties. Okay, and you can see the reason why I have not tried to give you a formal definition of this. Okay, so this is the guy we're interested in for now, and I think in the interest of time, MG will be present in the background. I'll make some remarks, but limited. So this is what we'll look at. And what I want to recall about it is that if I take the boundary of it, let's call it D bar, is an irreducible divisor. I never proved it for you because I didn't define this guy, but still. And D bar is the closure of the open part of the boundary, which is just the universal family of dimension one less, quotient by plus minus one, that I have actually constructed formally. So I have formally constructed for you a partial toroidal compactification, which is obtained by attaching to the moduli space of smooth principally polarized abelian varieties this stratum. Okay? So this is what we'll need from the previous lecture. And my goals now are two. First, I'd like to compute the canonical class of this. And second, I'd like to prove that this canonical class is big for G sufficiently large. So let's compute the canonical class first. So for this, I should really tell you something about line bundles on AG. And there is a theorem. This is a wonderful theorem due to Borel, which says that the Picard group of AG is one dimensional. And I write Q, and I'll write Q here. And I should be talking about Q divisors, because after all, this is a stack or an orbifold, and it would be very hard for me to define formally what an actual line bundle is. So I should allow Q coefficients, and then I don't have to worry. This is a theorem, the proof of which is topological. So you say that the Ziegel upper half space is contractible, which is very easy to see from its definition. And then you proceed to compute H2 of the symplectic group. And you show that this is Q. And then you make sure that this tells you that the Picard group is also Q. The proof is not at all easy. I mean, it's not so hard if you're an expert on groups, but it goes far beyond what we are. So it would be nice to identify a generator. So the generator is usually denoted lambda, and I'd like to define lambda for you. Definition. Let E over AG be the rank G complex vector bundle, which is of one forms. I don't know what you call it, but people usually call it the Hodge bundle. So what this means is that the fiber over an abelian variety is the space of holomorphic one forms on this abelian variety, which is a g-dimensional complex vector space. Okay? I'm not supposed to define line bundles like that, vector bundles like that, right? Because I cannot tell you what a vector bundle is by telling you what its fibers are, so I should have a better definition. So, in fact, what I should do is I should write this. Okay, this is a correct definition. This is a push forward of the bundle of relative one forms from the universal family. If you prefer, you think this way. If you are more formal, you think this way. It's the same object anyway. Okay? And then lambda, by definition, will be the determinant of E. So this is a line bundle. On AG. Okay? And I will also denote by the same letter lambda its Chern class. So lambda also denotes and I'm sorry I will be making this notation throughout because otherwise I'll get confused. So lambda for me means both the line bundle and its Chern class in the second homology group of the abelian, of the moduli space for abelian varieties. And this is a generator. So this is an undeniable line bundle. I have just defined it. You need to check that it's non-trivial. Then if you believe that the result is one-dimensional, it is generated by this line bundle and its ample. And the theorem of Bailey and Borel, and if I write it this way, maybe Igusa and Mumford, is the following, that lambda extends to a line bundle on this Sataki compactification. And lambda is ample on this Sataki compactification. Now, if you believe that this is a quasi-projective variety, you better believe there is some line bundle in it, which will be ample, and that's your line bundle. Okay? So now I'll do a horrible thing. So lambda, when I write lambda, I mean many different things. I mean a line bundle on AG, on AG Sataki, or an AG perfect cone. Recall that AG perfect cone compactification admits a contracting morphism to AG Sataki. And here I have a line bundle lambda, and I can pull it back, and I'll keep denoting the pullback lambda. I will not change notation, okay? But keep this in mind. Okay? Good. So at least now we know something. As a corollary of all this discussion, you see that the Picard group, again with Q coefficients, of the perfect cone toroidal compactification is two-dimensional and is generated by two classes, lambda and delta, where delta is the class of the boundary. Okay? Because the boundary is an irreducible divisor, and that's all you're adding. Another corollary, I mean, you will see a fact, we won't prove it, but this is very easy now, is that AG perfect cone is Q factorial. Which is to say anywhere any Q whale divisor is a Q Cartier divisor, which is to say that I don't have to worry about the difference between whale and Cartier divisors, which otherwise I might have to do on a singular variety. The reason this is the case, I just need to exhibit for you two different line bundles. One will be lambda, and another one would be the, any other bundle I can think of, which is not proportional to lambda. So you basically take a modular form, whatever this means, which will vanish on the boundary to some degree, and this modular form will have a class which will be a multiple of lambda minus a multiple of delta. And then once you have two different Cartier divisors on a variety for which the Picard rank is 2, and this should mean the Weyl Picard rank, then it's Q factorial. Okay. If you didn't like the discussion, forget it. I mean, what I just said was that every co-dimension one subvariety of AG bar is a line bundle, if you allow Q coefficients. Okay, so our goal now is to compute the canonical bundle. But before, let's go. Goal, compute the canonical class. And now I understand what I'm saying when I say compute the canonical class. I'm supposed to tell you two numbers, the coefficients of these two classes in my chosen basis. And I should be able to tell you what these are. And the boundary, you know, I'll cheat my way out of completely, the canonical class on AG, what is this? This is the C1 of the cotangent bundle to AG, right? So I should tell you what the cotangent bundle to AG is. If I succeed in telling you what this is, then I should be able to compute this C1. And let's leave some space. So for MG, recall that if I have a cotangent space at a point to MG, no bars, this is a space of quadratic differentials. Okay? Hopefully you saw this in Eduardo's talks last week. If you did not, you maybe saw this, which gives this by third duality. Okay? So with this, maybe you will believe me when I tell you the following fact, that the cotangent bundle to AG is actually sim2 of E. Okay, you should see some similarity here. Okay, this requires a proof. Analytically, the quickest maybe way to prove this is to say the word heat equation for the theta function. The moment you have said this word, this tells you that if I take both sides and tensor them with the theta line bundle, whatever that is, they're equal because the theta function satisfies the heat equation, and that's it. Okay. Algebraically, you have to prove it. If you believe this argument, you should believe that you can obtain proofs like that. I won't do this here, but this is the result. And this means I should be able to compute the C1. So let me go here. This will be some more space for MG. So now I should be able to compute. Yes? Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, you can see, yes, but I don't want to go into deformation theory.
Okay.
So there are many ways to prove this. The word heat equation somehow is very near here. And, you know, theta functions are close to my heart, and I feel so bad I have not written the word theta on the blackboard that I wanted to mention that. But yes, this, you can see this from deformation theory, if you do it carefully. But I don't want to go there. So I'm just asking you to believe this. And basically, you know, you can write d tau ij is equal to d dzi d dzj, if you know what I'm writing. And this is a proof. Okay, but this is a statement from deformation theory. This is an analytic proof if you've proven this. Okay. So I'm just saying this is how it's done. And then you compute the C1, and this is the C1 of sim2e. So I mean, this is a fancy way to write where computing the determinant of sim2e. And of course, this has to be the determinant of e, because everything is generated by the determinant of e to some power. And then you need to figure out the power, and the power will be g plus 1. Okay. How do you compute this? You compute this using churn weights. So you compute this, compute using churn weights, using churn whatever, roots. Sorry. This means pretend that E is a direct sum of a bunch of line bundles. And if you have pretended it's a direct sum of line bundles, then of course SIM2 will also be a direct sum of line bundles. And you can easily compute this. And you will see the power g plus 1. And then since we're computing Chern classes, everything behaves as if it were a sum of line bundles. This is what the business about Chern roots tells you. Okay? And if I, this is my E, the SIM2, well, there'll be like things like Li tensor Lj, and then when I take the tensor, there'll be G things that I just tensor Li and Lj, and then the extra one is because I'm tensoring Li with Li. Okay, so this is a G plus one. Very good. Now, what happens about, so this means that KAG is equal to, okay, this is what this says. I just computed that this is a G plus first power. Well, I didn't compute, I told you this is how to compute lambda. Okay. My next goal should be to compute the canonical class of the compactification. The canonical bundle of the compactification is G plus 1 lambda minus the version of this, which means I should twist this by the log of the boundary, and then you are done. If you are a down-to-earth person, what you may want delta. Okay. How do you prove this? If you are a fancy person, you write a is you just write the d tau 1 1 wedge d tau 1 2 wedge d tau gg is a section of the canonical bundle, right? Local coordinates on AG are the same as local coordinates on the Ziegler-Lapa half space. I've just taken a wedge product of all of them. So this is a section of the canonical bundle. If you are good with Mortular forms, you can just check how the symplectic group acts here, you'll get the G plus 1 immediately. But now you see this vanishes to order 1 as tau 1 is equal to 0. And this is a boundary component. And the fact that it vanishes to order 1 means the coefficient here is 1. So this is really an easy computation. Okay, so I have computed the canonical class of AG bar, modulus the fact I didn't prove this, which comes from deformation theory elsewhere. Or if you don't like deformation theory, you can just look at how this transforms under the symplectic group, this will also work. Since we haven't covered either, I won't do this. Okay, now let me take 2 minutes and take a step back and say something about MG. I won't have more than 2 minutes for this, well, maybe five. How about MG? What is the canonical class of MG bar, right? I'm supposed to compute using this idea the C1 of this, you know. But this is not so clear. I mean, such a cheap way does not work, okay? So to compute this, you can use Gross and Decreeman Roch. And that's the correct computation. This is the correct way to do it. And if I had another hour, I would have loved to do this, but I don't have another hour. And I'm not going to work on MG, so I won't tell you what Gross and Decreeman Roch is. And I won't tell you how to apply it. If you know what it is, you should be able to apply it quite easily. How else can you compute it? Well, there is a simple trick. Let me explain the simple trick. The simple trick requires some geometric understanding, but nothing about Gross and Decreeman Roch. So the simple trick is as follows. You take M3 bar, M3 maybe, M3 bar, and map it to A3 bar. Okay? This is a Torelli map. This is 2 to 1 branched along the hyperelliptic locus. As we discussed before. Let's call this map, I need some letter. Well, J was the map, the letter we used. Okay? So if I have a double branched cover, it's very easy to see how the canonical class changes. So this means the canonical class of M3 bar is the pullback of the canonical class of A3 bar plus the class of the hyperelliptic locus. This would be true if this map did not contract divisors. Unfortunately, it contracts a divisor. So, plus contracted divisors. Okay. But anyway, this tells you something. The class of the hyperelliptic locus you can compute very easily from geometry. If you know that this is written by a theta null modular form, it comes out immediately. So this is 9 lambda minus 2 minus delta, sorry. This is a class in H2 of A3 bar. Okay? So thus, the canonical bundle of M3 bar is the pullback of this guy. This is 4 lambda minus delta, g is equal to 3.
So, Sam, is hyperelliptic locus, is it in M3 or A3?
It's isomorphic in both places. This formula for its class is a correct formula for its class in M3. Sorry. In M3. And I should put delta 0. Here, plus 0, 9 lambda minus delta 0, plus some number times delta 1. Well, what are this delta 0 and delta 1? So delta 0 is this locus, and delta 1 is this locus. Okay, and this locus gets contracted by the Jacobian map, because as I explained, we forget the point of attachment. So I don't know this coefficient, but this is easy enough to compute. And so result that I see from here is that the canonical class of M3 bar is 13 lambda minus 2 delta. Let's not worry too much about the coefficients. This is basically a correct formula. This is how you'll find it in many textbooks. This was an extremely cheap computation. No growth and decrement row inside. If I know this, then I actually can compute the canonical class of mg bar inductively by trying to somehow bootstrap this to the canonical class of M3 with a bunch of marked points, and this is the boundary of M4, and then I'll use a junction, and then I'll need to understand something about the restriction of these classes to the boundary, which is not so hard and very explicit, and there is as a result, I'll be able to inductively prove this. Okay. This requires admittedly more work, but no gross and decrement row, and a good understanding of geometry. Okay, so this is just for the record. This is a school and moduli of curves, and if this was never written on the blackboard, I would feel bad. Okay. You should take this with a slight grain of salt, so the delta 1 is stacky, so we may want to write a coefficient for it a bit differently. Okay. But this is how you think about it. Gross and decrement row, correctly applied for stacks, gives you a correct answer with no further work. But we don't go there. Notice, by the way, that for computing this from gross and decrement row, I did not need to know the generators of mg bar, actually, because the gross and decrement row just gives you an answer. Computing it this way, I needed to know the generators of the Picard group of mg bar. And there is an analog of Borel's result that the Picard group of AG is generated by lambda, which is a theorem of Harrer, which says the Picard group of MG is generated by lambda. And then the analog would be to say that the Picard group of AG, of MG bar is generated by lambda in each of the boundary divisors. This argument uses this. Grossen decrement Roch does not. Okay? This was the last time you saw MG bar on the blackboard. Any questions about MG bar? Good. So I think we are mostly done with the preamble. Now we have to work. Yeah. Yes.
When you write k equals 13 lambda minus 2 delta, it might be that there are some effective divisors. I mean,
so the only divisors that could be here, I mean, for M3 bar, right? The only other thing that could be is some contracted divisor.
Okay.
The only contracted divisor on M3 bar is delta 1.
Okay.
If I want to prove this for arbitrary genus, I'll need to do more work geometrically, which I'm not sure. And I'll need, so M3 2 is a boundary divisor in M4 bar, right? And I'll know the canonical class of M3 2 bar by working with this and saying M3 2 is a vibration over M3. I can compute the canonical class. Then I'll use the adjunction formula on M4 bar to say that the canonical class of M4 bar plus the class of the boundary divisor restricted to the boundary is the canonical of the boundary, which I know. This will immediately give coefficient 13 here, and then I'll have to suffer through all the boundary contributions. Did I answer your question or did I not?
My only question is, this formula is true like that? Or
yes.
Okay.
The Picard group of MG bar is generated by classes lambda and the boundaries. So delta here means all of the boundary. So the boundary has many irreducible components. You should take them all. With coefficients 2 except the delta 1 is stacky, you fudge something. No further questions on MG bar. We are done with moduli of curves. The school is over. Okay. Okay. Good. We're on schedule. Goal for G large enough, show that KAG bar is effective. Actually, I'll show it's big. The difference is not that big. The big cone is the interior of the effective cone, so this will not be so far away. So that's my goal for now. So how do you do this? Proposition. Freytag. And this is 1980-something, 1980s. Forget the year, sorry. There exists an effective divisor called theta null on AG bar such that its class is some not so pleasant but not so bad expression. This is a theta null divisor. This is the locus of abelian varieties which have a vanishing theta null. I didn't define this word, so I cannot tell you what this means, but this is the definition. So let's try to understand what this means for applications. Okay? So note, if E equal to some A lambda minus B delta is effective on AG bar, then, you know, A plus epsilon lambda minus B delta is big for any epsilon greater than zero. Because lambda was ample on the Sataki complexification, so it pulls back to something bigger than F on AG bar. So the moment I have an effective divisor, I know that a little bit more of lambda will be big. There is no reason for me not to pull put a coefficient m here. The same argument works. You know, bigness or effectiveness or something like that, for me, is always invariant under multiplying by any rational number, right? And we're talking about Q divisors, we don't worry about this. So definition. The slope S of E of this form is defined to be simply A over B. Okay. And what this tells you, it says if there exists effective E on AG bar of slope less than g plus 1, less than or equals a, then the canonical class, well, less, then the canonical class is big. Okay. The slope just measures the ratio, and all this matters here is the ratio. This is what I indicated by multiplying by n here. I could have as well just erased this and this, right? And then work up to multiples. So if I want to prove that the canonical bundle of AG bar is big, which is normally called AG bar's general type, I have to find an effective divisor. And of course, this is if and only if. Okay. So you look at this divisor and you compute its slope. And maybe you make a mistake, maybe you don't. And with some luck, you don't, and you get something like 8 plus 2 to the power something horrible. 3 minus 2g or something. I don't know. Looks about right to me. Okay. So what is this? This is 8 plus something rather small. Okay. So this is less than g plus 1 if and only if g is at least 8. Yeah. Corollary. AG bar is general type for any g at least 8. Okay, so the method here is the following. You just exhibit by a geometric construction an effective divisor of slope this number. If its slope is less than g plus 1, which is the slope of the canonical bundle is big. And this is also the method that has been used for mg bar. So mg bar was proven to be general type for g at least 24. By Harris and Mumford, Eisenbad, and so on. There is lots of work by Gabi Farkas on general type for genus 22. There are results in genus 23. And the methods have been this. You exhibit an effective divisor of slope less than the slope of the canonical bundle of mg bar. In this direction, there is the best result is a theorem of Mumford. So it says that the slope of the so-called Andriotti-Meyer divisor, defined by Andriotti and Meyer, on AG bar is the following. the divisor is usually denoted on 0, and the slope is 6 plus 12 over g plus 1, which is also the slope of the Brill-Noether divisor on mg bar for reasons that are unbeknown to me or to anybody else. Okay? And the corollary is that ag bar is general type, which means k ag bar is big for any g at least 7. You can check that if I plug in 7 here, this is less than 8. Okay? And a up to 5 is unirational. This is the work of many people. For a up to 3, this is easy. For a4, this is Clemens. For a5, there are many different proofs by Morey, Mokai, Donaghi, and Vera. And the Kadaira dimension of a6 is unknown. And it's unknown since 1980s. And people have tried, including yours truly, and did not succeed. Okay? So that's the status. Okay? So for me to try to prove this would require to develop quite a bit of machinery. This is harder. Here, this computation really takes, you know, one paragraph once you have defined the theta null divisor. And for this, I would need to define the theta function, which I would love to do, but I won't. So now I would like to use the remaining 20 minutes to explain to you Thiele's proof redone that AG is general type for g at least 9, which actually predates those observations. And the reason I'd like to do it, which is weaker than the results I stated here and really takes longer than this, maybe, if I had the machinery of theta functions, is I think the technique has not been used much since, and it's very simple, and I'd like to do it. There will be two black boxes I'll need to use, which will be some geometric property of the boundary of AG bar and the computation of intersection numbers on AG bar. But I encourage you to think about the technique, not about these details. And my hope is that maybe if somebody invites me to give some talk in a couple of months, maybe I'll have a theorem like that for MG bar or some other space from this perspective. Okay? Any questions? So what I'll do now is I'll give you a proof, rather formal, I have to look at my notes, otherwise I'll make a mess in 20 minutes, that AG bar, if you wish, is general type for G at least 9. So for this, I'll need to do something, and it won't be this. I will not construct geometrically an effective divisor. What I'll do instead, I'll honestly compute, or rather bound, the dimension of the space of sections of multiples of the canonical. Okay? Any questions? Okay. Take a deep breath, buckle up for the ride. So this will be a very different style from everything we did before. Goal? Need to know for which AB the dimension of the space of sections of multiples of a divisor a lambda minus b delta grows like n to the top power for n going to infinity, where from now on I'll denote n to be the dimension of ag, which is ag, which is g times g plus 1 over 2. Okay? So this is a bigness test. The effectivity is slightly weaker, it just says there is a section. There is no difference in this method in getting one or the other. There shouldn't be, of course, because the big cone is the interior of the effective cone. And it will be just convenient for me to keep both A and B here, even though I could have thrown one out. Okay. So let's do it. So remember that I have a divisor, boundary divisor D bar inside a G bar, and the open part D is X G minus 1 quotient by plus minus 1, right? These are my notations. And I'm using lambda and delta to mean both classes and divisors. Whenever I'm computing dimensions of the space of sections, obviously this is divisors. Okay, let's take the usual exact sequence, 0, I, D bar, big space, O, A, G bar, O, D bar, 0. Right? This is the inclusion exact sequence. At least that's what I am used to calling it. Twisted. So this means I tensored it with this line bundle. Okay? Write the long exact. Long exact sequence in homology. Cohomology, of course, sorry. So what happens? You have H0, 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 H1. The H1 I'll have no idea about, right? So what I'll get is the obvious bound, H naught on AG bar of A lambda minus B delta is at most H naught of AG bar A lambda minus B plus 1 delta plus H naught on D bar on A lambda minus B delta restricted to D bar. Right? I'm interested in H naught of the middle guy, and it's at most the sum of the two H naughts. The H1 contributes with a negative sign. Okay, and the H1 I have no idea about. Okay? So now I'll add this for B going from 0 to somewhere. And of course, what I'll get, and I'll invert the inequality. So I'll get H naught on AG bar of A lambda minus B delta, which is really what I wanted, is at least H naught on AG bar A lambda minus the sum where J goes from 0 to B, H naught on D bar, A lambda minus J delta on D bar. Okay? So you see, if this coefficient went up by 1, this H naught is at least this minus that. You add this up together, inductively you get this bound. This is all trivial and straightforward manipulation. I haven't done anything. The reason I'm looking in my notes, I'm sure if I did it without the notes, the pluses and minuses will be in all the wrong places. But otherwise, you can reconstruct it. And if we had 1 hour instead of 20 minutes, I would try to reconstruct it more proactively so it would see. Okay? So far, everything is trivial. So lambda is big enough. So for A sufficiently large, if I want to compute the dimension of the space of sections of A lambda, this is just the top self-intersection number. This is asymptotic Riemann row, I guess. Okay. So this is A to the top power times to the top power intersection number, and you divide by n factorial, plus little o of a to the n. Okay? Asymptotic Riemann Roch. The dimension of the space of sections is just the top self-intersection number for sufficiently positive line bundles. Did I already say something wrong?
No, I proved it in the first week.
Huh?
I even proved it in the first week. Oh, perfect. Okay. So as Olivier proved for you in the first week. Yeah. So this is what we have. Okay. Why did I go through all of this little tap dance? You see, the problem is, of course, if A lambda minus B delta were ample to start with, I would just say that's the intersection number. Of course, it's not ample. I cannot assume this. My goal is to prove it's effective, so I cannot assume it's ample. This guy is bigger than F, which is good enough for this statement, right? And here I get a bound that says this is at least that much minus stuff. If somehow I could get rid of the minus stuff, I'd be done, right? Of course, I cannot get rid of the minus stuff, but okay, let's try. So we need to understand this. Okay. So lambda restricted to D bar is just lambda. Right? Lambda comes from a pullback from down below, it doesn't see anything. What is delta restricted to D bar? I mean, this is a self-intersection of delta with itself. So I know what is delta, I can compute what is delta restricted to D. It's actually minus ample, so this is minus T, minus big enough. This is a universal theta divisor, by which I mean the universal polarization. On this, trivialized along the zero section. Okay, so this is a fact that I won't be able to prove. Given not so much time, I would be able to prove it. If you just look at our analytic description of a partial compactification, I'm computing the normal bundle to the boundary. I can just do it analytically in coordinates. This would come out immediately. Okay? So this is not so bad. If I now want to compute the restriction to all of the boundary, well, this will be there, extended suitably, plus the class of the rest. You can convince yourself of that also quite easily. Notice that here, somehow, without declaring so, I'm heavily using the fact that we're on the perfect cone compactification. I'm using the fact that the boundary is irreducible when I'm writing this formula. I'm also using the fact that the complement of the open part of the boundary is codimension 1 within the boundary. Okay? Okay, so this comes from the definition of how I glued things in. This basically comes for free once you understand what this is about. So now I want to understand this number. So this is H naught. I just wrote down what the restrictions were. And now you do the silliest estimate you could possibly imagine. This is something effective. So you just write this as, at most, you just drop it. Okay. So something, I mean, I feel bad that I didn't explain this, but this is how it works. You can take this as a definition of the divisor T. At some point, you'll have to believe me for one other fact about it, and we'll be good. So let's try to use this here. So I'd like to use this here. This thing here, A lambda plus j
for a is for a greater than 0 and j greater than equal to 0 is big enough. Both big enough on the boundary. Because the boundary is this universal vibration over AG minus 1. This thing, lambda, is ample on AG minus 1. This is the universal polarization. The universal polarization means on each fiber, this is a polarization. This is an ample line bundle. So the sum is basically ample. This is really ample. Okay, so thus, H naught on D of this behaves like the top self-intersection number again. The top self-intersection number is now in degree one less because we're intersection on the boundary, and I have to divide by n minus 1 factorial. Okay? I would already say that we have made significant progress, even though it may not look like that. What I have succeeded in doing so far, I have reformulated a question in birational geometry into a question about intersection numbers. If you look at this setup carefully, I used precisely nothing about the fact we're on the moduli space of abelian varieties. You need to interpret this as such, and you need to make sure that this thing is effective that you are throwing out. Okay? And you can do a more refined version, which Tai did not do, and hopefully somebody, maybe me, will do, and try to get better bounds. But already from here, you can see, so need to show that So conclusion. If the following holds, if that intersection, say if a to the n times lambda to the n on AG bar over n factorial minus the sum of these things j goes from 0 to b minus 1 is greater than 0, I mean is greater than 0 for a, then the bundle I started from is ample. Maybe B, I'm not sure. Okay. So this is already something. Now let me try to explain to you how this is computed. And this will use the specifics of AG. And this is a part that I don't know how to do for MG at the moment. So let's recall that I'm computing on the boundary and I'll be sloppy. I'll somehow allow myself to pretend I'm not compactifying. So recall we have the universal family of dimension one less. There is a plus minus one missing, mapping to AG minus one. This is a map pi. And here we have a class lambda. And lambda written there is really the pullback of lambda from down below. And now what I need to do is I want to compute the intersection number as written. So I want to compute the intersection number, and let me emphasize this as a pullback, plus this to the power n minus 1 on xg minus 1. Okay?
And how do you compute this? There is a projection formula, right? This tells you it's a sum over all I from 0 to n minus 1, a to the I, lambda to the I, times n minus 1 choose I, times j to the power n minus 1 minus I, times the push forward of t to the n minus 1 minus I. All of this intersected on the base. Yeah, this is a projection formula. If I open up the parentheses, all powers of this are pullbacks from the base. So the intersection number I can compute downstairs by pushing forward the other class. This is some intersection theory, which is rather basic. Okay, well, what do we see? Well, lambda is a class down below, right? So if its power is higher than the dimension of A, this tells us, it tells us that if the power of lambda is higher than this dimension, this is zero. So instead of summing here in a silly way up to n minus 1, it's enough to sum up to the dimension of AG minus 1. Okay. Now you have two options. This is this big expression. And what you really care about is not the entire expression. You care the term that will multiply a to the n once you have taken a sum, right? Because this will be the leading order term. So fact, there are two ways. You can either estimate this directly, but the fact, which is a very useful fact for any kind of such computation, is the following, that if you take t to the power, I think we haven't used the letter k, this is equal to g minus 1 factorial times the class of 1, the fundamental class, if the power is the dimension and 0 else. Okay. This requires some work. You don't need all of this. You actually only need to know that the leading order term in this, in terms of powers of A, will be the one coming from here. This is much easier to show, but I promise this is true. And using this becomes easier because instead of the sum, I can just write one term, right? Because the one term I'm supposed to write the push forward here of t to the g minus 1, right? And then I can see what the rest should be. So this should be n minus 1, choose g minus 1. And there should be a to the power g times g minus 1 over 2 out in front. There should be j to the power g minus 1. And then this will be lambda to the top degree on a g minus 1. Okay, I will take another maybe 3 minutes or so because we'll be done very shortly. Okay. So now I'm supposed to sum this for j going from 0 to some b. And what do I get? I get, you know, a big, big coefficient times the sum of j to the power g minus 1 for j going from 0 to b. Okay? I mean, everything here is independent of j. The only part that depends on the j is that. And this sum, well, this is a sum of powers, right? It behaves basically like b to the g. Right? And then there are some Bernoulli numbers. Okay. Let's call this constant Cg. This is an explicit constant. It's some combination of a Bernoulli number, zeta value, if factorial and so on. I don't want to, I mean, this is a Bernoulli number divided by factorial. Okay. Whew. Okay. Let's look here. So the then let B be equal to A divided by S. That was our real interest, right? We wanted the slope. So S is the slope of this guy. And I'm interested in this expression. So this expression here is equal to, well, some term of degree less than maximal, which I don't care about, plus a to the n times a big coefficient, which is lambda to the n on ag bar divided by n factorial minus c to the cg times all the junk that comes from here, g minus 1 factorial there was an n minus 1 factorial in there. There was an n minus 1 choose g minus 1, which neatly cancels most of this stuff here. G minus 1 factorial came from here, times lambda to the top degree in dimension 1 less. And very importantly, times 1 over s to some power, g minus 1. G. Okay. Doesn't really matter what I wrote here. I mean, it matters for precise computations, but the idea is there is some coefficient here which I can compute explicitly. Okay. So if this whole thing is greater than 0, then A lambda minus A over S delta is big. Okay? This is what we proved. Because this is what it says. If this is bigger than 0, then this is, well, big. Oh, sorry, this was not ample. This was supposed to be big at all times. I'm sorry. Okay, ampleness I will never detect. Okay, let's look at this coefficient here. It's some ugly, ugly expression. But this s, the slope, appears in the denominator. So no matter what this number is, no matter what this number is, I will get an s. So I will, if s is small enough, if s goes to 0, this goes to something which is positive. This is a self-intersection number of an ample divisor. It's positive. So this means I will get a bound for the slope, irrespective of any numerics along the way. This method always gives you a bound for the slope. And this is somehow its beauty. So now I need to tell you how this is computed. So lambda to the n on AG bar computed by, here's the Brook proportionality, on the symplectic Grassmannian. And there is a nice enough formula. Lambda to the n is some kind of expression, and there are some zeta values and some factorials and some powers and some product for j equal 1 to g and 2 to the minus g and some n factorial, and that's about it. Okay? So it's very explicit. This Hirzebruch proportionality comes from the fact that symplectic group is also the fundamental group. I mean, it also acts on a contractible space with the quotient being the symplectic Grassmannian. On that, you have the Schubert calculus, so we can compute intersection numbers. Okay, so you take this thing, which I wrote down. I mean, I can look up the formula. And so result, the final result is that A lambda minus A over S delta on AG is big if S is at least, and now I need to look up the formula. Two pi squared divided by 2g factorial zeta of 2g to the power 1 over g. Okay? Some formula. Okay? Let me say, you can plug this in and you will see two corollaries. So this means kag bar is big for g at least 9. You need to compare the slope to g plus 1. You do this computation, you do get g equal at least 9. And the second corollary, you get that the slope, the thing, so there exists a big divisor on ag bar of slope O of 1 over g for g large enough. What do I mean by this? If you look at this formula here, this goes to 1 as g goes to infinity, and this guy behaves like g over e to the power g. So if I extract everything, there is a g in the denominator and some constant upstairs. So this tells me that there exist big dividers on ag bar of slopes that go to 0. Okay? If you were able to write mg bar here and prove this theorem by any method, you would get, I forget, either $100 from Ian Morrison or a bottle of wine from Gabby Farkas or both, but they have a bet about the slopes of big effective, makes no difference, effective device on mg bar as g goes to infinity. This is the only known proof that the slope of ag bar goes to 0 as g goes to infinity. The method of constructing effective device on ag bar does not give such a result. There is no explicit divisor known or on AG bar or on MG bar of slope less than 6. And 6 is not 1 over G. Okay, so that's the story. And hopefully at some point somebody will give a similar talk and there'll be a theorem at the beginning and the word AG will become an MG. Okay, this is not known. And there are still questions left. Sorry, I'm horribly over time and thank you.